and welcome to NewsClick. Today we have with us D. Raghunandan, President of All India People Science Network, to discuss the latest tropical storm or cyclone, Phailin. Raghu, good to have you with us. This time, the scale of disaster has been considerably less in terms of people killed than the earlier 1999 cyclone that hit Orissa and also the much earlier one which had hit Andhra Pradesh.
That's right.
Do you think this time the government of India and the disaster management system has been much better equipped?
Certainly. They've learnt their lessons the hard way from 1999, where more than 10,000 lives were lost. And what they've essentially done is to have, they've built new storm shelters all along the coast, dotted on the coast, plus they've identified school buildings and other government structures as storm shelters. So they had got good advance warning of the cyclone this time, and based on that they decided to go in for mass evacuation if necessary by force. They compelled people who were even unwilling to move out from the coastal areas, not very far, but they took them by buses and trucks into storm shelters, which are essentially fairly large pakka buildings, brick and cement and mortar structures, which had been very well organized with bedding, places to sleep, food for the people who had taken shelter. A total of close to 900,000 people were evacuated and taken to storm shelters in Orissa and Andhra.
And that's that a very large number.
Huge number. That's massive. And that has been the major reason why they had taken as a priority, we may not be able to do much to save property and kaccha houses, but let's save lives. And that, I think, has worked out well. And it was done very well, coordinated very well. To me, it shows that when India wants to do something, it can. So wherever we don't see it happening, it shows that there has been lack of attention to that.
So also the fact that there was early advanced planning done from long before.
That's right.
So there was this expectation that if a cyclone takes place, what is it that we need to do?
That's right.
That taken that apart, give it that as it may be. There's also some dispute about the cyclone itself.
Sure.
There are a lot of people who called it a super cyclone.
Sure.
Predicted wind speeds above 250 kilometers.
Sure.
But this appears to be a very big cyclone, but not a super cyclone.
Well, it was a cyclone on a scale of 1 to 5, which is the normal thing which is measured. The super cyclone is classified as category 5 cyclone. This one was a category 4 cyclone. Now, it looks like a big difference. Frankly speaking, it's not that big. In the sense, a category 5 cyclone would expect wind speeds of 200 to 220 kilometers an hour. A category 5, you would expect wind speeds of around 250 kilometers an hour.
Anything above 220 is categorized.
That's right.
Five.
Now, what had happened was that the Joint Tropical Weather Center, the Joint Typhoon Weather Center in the US, had classified it as category 5. And till about 3 days ago, it had actually reached category 5 and then it slowed down. So it was category 4 when it actually hit the Orissa coast.
So when it made landfall,
it was category 4 and for about a day before that. However, I must add that the IMD, I think, had done a better job of tracking and classifying the cyclone, probably because it had better data this time than the normally reliable U.S. Joint Typhoon Weather Center, partly because the data that the IMD had was also based on local. You would remember that after the tsunami, India had installed a large number of buoys in the Arabian Sea. So this chain
and
Indian Ocean. Oh, and on the Indian Ocean. So this chain of buoys that had been set up, which then sent signals up into satellite, which are then received in the control center, enabled IMD to track the cyclone and to give a more accurate reading of the cyclone's progress and its strength than I think other stations.
A lot of it is advanced preparation again.
That's right.
In the wake of the tsunami, as you rightly pointed out. And also the fact that cyclone is something that periodically happens.
That's right.
In this whole coast, starting from Bengal to
That's right.
Andhra Pradesh, even down to Tamil Nadu. So this time, preparation showed that this has been partially successful. Of course, there could be things which could be improved.
But sure.
Property, etc., is something that is very difficult
That's right.
to do anything about unless you change the housing codes, and more important, people have the money.
That's right.
And this population really is a question of the,
That's
they
right.
don't really have the money.
In Ganjam district alone, 250,000 kacha houses along the coast belonging to fishermen and the poor people. Obviously, in 220 kilometer winds, not a single one of those structures is going to survive.
And 45,000 electricity poles have
That's
been
right.
destroyed in
That's
Andhra Pradesh.
That's right.
We don't have full
That's
reports
right.
of forest fires.
That's right. We don't yet have.
So there are obviously large-scale devastation that
yes.
has taken place to infrastructure, to houses, and
That's
so
right.
on. Trees uprooted.
That's right.
But at least lives have
Lives
been
have
saved.
Not. And that's a big thing. Big.
Coming to the question that you had raised earlier about India's will to do things, Uttarakhand was really a contrast where yes. the disaster management failed completely. And what has now been said, of course, it's not admitted by the government as yet, but the team monitoring the glacial melts was really not in place, so they're supposed to be there, and also therefore there was no advance warning. So does it show that disaster management in Uttarakhand was far worse? A, preparations were much worse, and also the necessary warnings were not issued.
Absolutely. On both counts, I think. One is the early warning structures, systems, infrastructure, whether they are in place or not. And clearly in Uttarakhand, they were not.
The interesting part is there apparently is a group of people who are supposed to monitor
That's
the
right.
glacier.
That's right.
Who's melting due
That's
to the
right.
rains is the really that caused the overflow of the lake and then the far
That's
further
right.
disaster. It the people are supposed to be there, but they obviously were either missing or they didn't inform
there was
or
one,
the information was not
yeah,
up to the point.
There was one team which had actually reached the lake and they found that it was in danger of overflowing, but communications had broken down. They couldn't get the message down. They tried to actually reach by foot. By the time they reached by foot to Kedarnath, the
water had already reached the
temple town. So on the one hand, there is the early warning part of it. And the preparedness is not only by early warning, it's by what you do when you know that what you expect is going to happen. And that was completely absent in Uttarakhand. For example, here in Orissa and Andhra Pradesh, knowing that this is going to happen, they already had some infrastructure available in the form of the storm shelters. 5 days before, when they knew the strength of the cyclone that it was going to hit, they arranged buses and trucks and trucked people out into safer areas. Nothing of this kind either existed or was attempted in Uttarakhand. Incidentally, it also shows one of the big advantages which enables you to do what you are able to do in Orissa and Andhra is the availability of good roads, good communication infrastructure, trucks and buses, and roads which can take heavy vehicles. And you would know that many environmentalists are clamoring in Uttarakhand for not building roads and so on. And you can imagine how much worse things could have been or would be in future if we don't have sufficiently strong and good road infrastructure in the hills to be able to evacuate people or take them to safer zones. The other thing is the construction of shelters, which is required in Uttarakhand, where attention has not been paid to that aspect.
Location as well as the construction
That's right.
of shelters.
That's right.
It does point out that if advanced preparations are made, plans for disaster management are there, and advanced warning systems built
yes.
the way it has been built now for cyclones, we can see, then future disasters in Uttarakhand can be mitigated.
Yes.
I will add
one point to the list that you enumerated, and that is whether these plans and proposals are implemented well. Because as we know, in India, we are fairly good at making plans. We are not particularly good at implementing them.
But Uttarakhand, the plans were also not there.
The plans were not there.
Fair,
the infrastructure
confidence.
Was not there. Exactly. And what I think the Orissa and Andhra response to the cyclone has shown was that there was actually excellent implementation of these plans. People were actually moved. They were actually taken to the cyclone shelters. The cyclone shelters were well equipped with bedding, medication, food, and there were people, staff in each of these shelters who were cooking food and supplying it to the people. Now that shows a very effective coordination, particularly by these district administration and by the staff around that. And that has been very effective, which also, of course, as we know, collapsed in Uttarakhand.
Last point on this, you know, Uttarakhand, the very heavy rainfall that occurred, and this kind of cyclones, this is supposed to be the kind of winds that were there, at least when it was, the cyclone was over the Bay of Bengal, where you said the wind speed really went up, would make it one of the strongest cyclones for the last decade.
That's right.
Do you think these are extreme weather events we are seeing as a consequence of climate change, particularly because IPCC has said that one of the clear indicators of global warming is ocean warming?
Yes.
And would that indicate the cyclones would be more frequent and would be actually stronger?
Very difficult to say, because the IPCC report, the fifth assessment report, which has recently been published, also says that compared to many other indicators of extreme weather, the correlation between the tropical cyclone's intensity and frequency and climate is only of medium confidence they are able to predict. They are not able to predict with a very high degree of confidence as to the correlation to climate. There could be many other factors involved. So they're not very sure how much climate change has played a role in these or not.
So extreme weather events increasing, yes,
yeah.
But we cannot draw a conclusion of a one-to-one correlation between a strong cyclone and climate change.
Or even the increased frequency of these cyclones, which seems to have been observed, but I think statistically that is not as significant yet. But you never know. The IPCC in further observations may update this in time to come.
But apart from that, high frequency events of extreme events have been increasing. So that is
extreme rainfall events definitely have increased, and there's a very good correlation on that. Cyclones, we are not yet sure.
Thank you very much, Raghu. Hope that we can discuss these issues further. Thank you.